but aren't prepared to fork out any more, even on a reproduction of the Frieze.
I think it would be a fair solution to the problem. Of course, it's a major financial problem. Technically, it could be done, I think. The techniques that we dispose of today would allow a very good replica.
You mean a copy of?
A copy of it.
No.
Why not?
Why not? Because I say something. Zeus altar belongs to Bergamo, the real altar, not copy of altar. I want a real altar. It's a historical bond. I don't want copy. I don't want altar as a show or as a American movie, historical movie. I want a part of my town back, not a copy of it.
All the mayor's claims about the illegal removal of the frieze are being investigated by a new Turkish government commission. No bill of sale exists, but subject to the commission's report, the Germans appear to have acquired the frieze legally, by 19th century standards at least. German moral claims to have rescued the frieze need to be taken with a large pinch of salt. It's in aesthetic, historical and emotional terms that the removal of the frieze from Pergamon should be considered as plunder, however civilized its disguise.
UN berries huddled together over a meal provided by Serb captors.
The grainy video grab pictures work wonders at stirring national resentment, like a rerun of the Gulf War.
UN caught in impasse as Bosnian Serbs use unarmed observers for human shield.
For news editors, the human shield offers two things that an anonymous Bosnian corpse can't. Human interest to the readers back home, and a dilemma, what to do about them. So the story, as they say, has legs. It will run and run. First priority is to talk to the families back in Blighty.
Get our boys home.
Sobs worried mum. Pregnant Claire Warren patted her tummy last night and said,
I just hope the baby's daddy is free by the time this one is born.
Claire's husband Nick, 28, one of the Royal Welsh Fusiliers seized in Bosnia, is desperate to be home for the birth in 5 months' time.
Natural enough. And the female angle isn't just to be found on the home front.
We send in the girls.
We being the army, not the sun.
Three brave army girls were last night helping to spearhead the massive airlift to save our boys in Bosnia.
There was little room for the day-to-day anguish of ordinary Bosnian civilians. A point brought home clearly by Robert Fox in the Telegraph when he reported on the horrific shelling of a cafe in Tuzla.
On Thursday night, the cafes in the charming old part of Tuzla were doing roaring business, with young people crowding the tables by the pavements. The few who could afford to do so were buying drinks, but most were just meeting and chatting. A few seconds later, 200 bodies lay shattered across the road and pavement.
He goes on.
The shelling was the worst single act of civilian carnage in the entire Bosnian War, yet it was buried among the verbiage of other news items on the day.
The maps of Bosnia themselves tell an interesting story.
Where the UN troops are in Bosnia-Herzegovina.
These maps used to show the whereabouts of the country's embattled populations, Croat, Serb and Muslim. Now they largely show the whereabouts of the embattled, panicking UN forces, along with escape routes for them to get the hell out of there.
Possible UN withdrawal routes.
And by them, I mean getting our boys the hell out of there. This one from the Telegraph in particular looks like the opening titles of Dad's Army. The Daily Mirror summed it up.
Major tells Serbs, hands off 33 Brit hostages, or else.
Yes, or else what? Or else we send in more troops who aren't allowed to defend themselves? Or else we all run away? The Mail pointed out the blur.
It was far from clear whether the new force was to strengthen British units or cover a withdrawal.
Yes, the hated W word, withdrawal. Once almost unthinkable, now used pretty well routinely in the newspapers. Even the papers that advocate staying on do so with a heavy heart. In the Lords, the departing EU peace negotiator, Lord Owen, used his favourite phrase for attacking the press.
Hopefully, we will hear less from the laptop bombardiers.
But they're an endangered species. Journalists are now pretty much laptop white flag wavers. But in a macho, patriotic way, of course. This is the Sun.
There is only one thing worth fighting for in Bosnia, the lives of British troops.
So much for standing up to tyranny in the heart of Europe.
We didn't get tough in Bosnia when it could have done some good, so now we should get out.
Also in the new troops out movement was the Telegraph.
Sound the retreat.
It bugled. And then the stayers came out of the woodwork, leaving the papers as hopelessly divided as everyone else, as the Independent showed with its handy guide to the split opinions. Alan Clark in the Mail said it was all about feuding tribes who were all as bad as each other.
There is a lot of loose talk about
the need to punish the aggressor.
Certainly the Serbs are a pretty rough lot.
Aspiring to genocide is pretty rough.
And in
ethnic cleansing,
have come up with what has to be the most politically incorrect phrase of the decade. But their own civilians have suffered cruelly at the hands of both Croats and Muslims.
True, but does that cancel everything out? Newspapers have to have a hate figure. This week they discovered Ratko Mladic, the Bosnian Serb commander.
Get the rat. Major targets Bosnian bully.
And Leslie in the Mail dissected the rat.
This man is a psychopath whose proudest boast is this.
We have no prisoners. We kill them all.
Today he holds the lives of 33 young British soldiers in his hands. He is the embodiment of a peculiarly Balkan concept, inat. This translates loosely as
vengeful spite.
And Melanie McDonough in the Evening Standard wrote,
what the present bout of hostage-taking has shown is the nature of the Bosnian Serb rebels. Not just their paranoia, their braggadocio, but their conviction that they can get away with murder.
Perhaps the only thing that's clear from the coverage is the formidable increase in military hardware being put to use in Bosnia.
1. Armoured Engineer Squadron.
2. Air Mobile Brigade.
3. 2 batteries of light artillery.
In the midst of the crisis, the FT, on its news pages, carried an advertisement that wasn't exactly in the best possible taste.
The new UK attack helicopter deserves a proven and British-built engine.
Now, which one should we buy?
The T-700 is unquestionably the most proven and reliable engine in its class. Today, some 1,200 AH-64 Apaches and AH-1W Cobra Venom types are flying with military operators worldwide. Operators who each selected the T-700 as the only choice of battle-proven engine for their attack helicopter needs.
Customer satisfaction guaranteed. Former Yugoslavia came up elsewhere in the news this week because this saw the climax of the Cannes Film Festival.
Epic film on tragedy of Yugoslavia wins top award at Cannes,
announced The Guardian sagely, accompanied with this picture.
Emir Kusturica, seen with the Hollywood actress Sharon Stone, shows off the Palme d'Or awarded to him last night.
Is Sharon's pose here really appropriate to honour this harrowing cinematic tragedy about Sarajevo? Who cares? This is Cannes, the capital of Eurotrash glamour. The whole point of everything is to take pictures of girls with no clothes on. Here's our Sharon in the Daily Mirror.
Stone me, just look at those hot pants.
As you can see, the fate of former Yugoslavia, obviously not yet preying on her mind. The very lovely Miss Pamela Anderson was present, as ever, sporting bulging plastic above and below the skin.
Taking plunge, Pamela goes bust.
Outward bound, playful Pam aims to shock in Cannes.
She was there to publicise her new film, Barb Wire. And Gareth Morgan of The Star was very overexcited to get
an exclusive.
Thank you.
Interview at the Cannes Film Festival.
Gareth crowed,
the pursuing media's Riviera disappointment was mirrored.
Ouch.
Clearly, as she said,
for the Daily Star, it's no problem at all. I'm only too glad to see you after all you've done for me in Britain.
Pamela gave a heartfelt message.
I hear all your readers love me, and sure as hell, I love them.
And Pamela gave her views on wedded bliss.
Being married is great.
She cooed.
And the Star's support makes me even happier.
Support? Oh, stop it, Mrs. Pamela's mere presence induced delirium in some journalists. The Guardian's Jonathan Romney hallucinated about seeing Ken Dodd on the Croisette.
What a lovely day. What a lovely day for going to the Pamela Anderson press conference, sticking your hand up and saying, excuse me, Mrs., but have you finished with my bicycle bump?
Elsewhere, the gorgeous, pouting Miss Nicole Kidman was showing the photographers a bit of leg. But not enough for leering hacks.
She failed to raise any eyebrows with her red flamenco number.
The Mail's Baz Bamigboy was in his celeb element as he quoted Nicole on how she landed her latest role, a TV weather presenter.
I told the director that he should give me it because otherwise he'd be standing in the way of destiny.
Probably the most gratuitous photograph was this one in the Sun.
Hugh's a lucky boy. A blonde shows her own double feature in front of Hugh Grant at the Cannes Film Festival.
A shot of an unknown girl taking her clothes off next to an unknown man with a beard, which merits inclusion because Hugh Grant, though not in the photo as such, was somewhere in the vicinity. Now, this isn't to say that the broadsheets aren't keen on a bit of sauce. What they do is photograph the paparazzi photographing the girls and sneer.
Baywatch actress Pamela Anderson poses. The press corps sniggers at
her assets.
This postmodern approach was taken to its logical conclusion by male hackette Lydia Slater, who hoaxed the paparazzi on the beach into thinking that she was the new Emily Lloyd. Her Svengali fellow May reporter Simon Sebag Montefiore, posing as a louche agent, confessed how he stoked the media feeding frenzy.
At the count of 10, She is to fall to her knees in the sea. After 2 more minutes of cavorting, I will take out the champagne in an ice bucket, which she is then to open, drink, and pour onto herself.
But suddenly, the party's over. The hijinks end, the ravers and party crashers leave, and then the cerebral critics are parachuted in, and the papers go into highbrow mode, as if they hadn't just spent the whole time smirking and ogling at girls. Derek Malcolm in The Guardian informs us solemnly about the various awards.
Other prizes went to Mathieu Kassovitz, named Best Director for the French film La Haine, to Xavier Beauvoir, who won the minor jury prize for N'oubliez pas que tu vas mourir.
That, fun lovers, means don't forget you are going to die.
And to Zhang Yimou, who got the Technical Accomplishment Award for Shanghai Triad.
Nothing for Pamela, then. Meanwhile, there was no hint of silicone in the manly breast of our World Cup rugby player, Will Carling, at his gorgeous best.
Captain Carling has matured in recent years into a national hero, and a good-looking hero to boot, with his darkly handsome features, cheeky grin and rugged profile. Even the cleft chin, which earned him that unflattering nickname, helps set female pulses racing when the cameras zoom in.
I should explain that this nickname is...
Bumface.
Before the first match against Argentina, the Mirror admiringly lined up the wives and girlfriends of our brave lads.
Will's rugby booties.
And the Sun gave us...
20 scrummy things you will love to know on Carling.
The first and most important being...
Princess Diana is one of Will's greatest fans.
And before the first big match against Argentina, the Mirror lined up Carling next to England cricketer Peter Martin and euphorically sang out...
Land of hope and glory!
But England's narrow win over Argentina with no tries was very unconvincing. And yes, of course, our sporting heroes got the turnip head treatment.
15 old farts!
Said the Sunday Mirror, punning on Carling's attack on the RFU officials and producing a string of hilarious fart gags, including...
World Cup stinker.
And...
Will Carling suffered a major blowout.
And...
ill wind.
Oh, stop it. The news of the world was fractionally less mean.
14 old farts plus one hero, Rob.
And that, of course, was Rob Andrew, who saved England's bacon with drop kicks and penalties, the man whose inspiring skills brought the muse of sports writing to Colin Price of The Mirror.
He's got the face of an angel, but kicks like the devil himself.
Well, quite. Rob himself is a columnist for The Times, thus reminding us that rugby is always going to be treated as just a little bit posher than football. Gazza might sign up for The Sun, but Rob Andrew is somehow a better fit with The Times. And when, a few days later, England narrowly beat the Italians, the papers once again rounded on our lads.
Gutless. It's past a joke, England.
All in all, though, newspapers edited from London tended to treat the English team as really the only important side. Gavin Hastings' triumphant performances for Scotland were marginalised. This spread from The Express shows how Gavin, far more successful than Will Carling, gets squeezed out to one column. This, from last Monday's Star, lets Gavin Hastings and Welsh captain Mike Hall peek over Will Carling's shoulders, but...
The best of British.
...is supposed to be English. The Mirror pictured the four British rugby captains together...
We'll rule the world.
But the position of the cup rather gives it away which country they want to rule the world. But in so many different fields, we're facing up to the fact that ruling the world isn't as easy as that. Good night.
If I rule the world, every day would be the first day of spring. Every heart would have a new song to sing.
Nice parts of Liverpool, and I come from a nice part. It's a little fishing village called Toxteth.
Out of this whole club of 200 or 300 people, there's probably only 10 who've actually got a full-time job.
Without jobs, how can there be working men? Without working men, how can there be clubs?
People come into clubs and leave the worries behind.
Some places that you go to have so little hope that you almost wish that you'd never been there.
The grind behind the glamour of the club entertainers, bringing some light relief to depressed communities. Fine Cut reveals the hidden voices of 90s Britain tonight at 8:50 on BBC Two.
In 50 minutes, the death penalty in America and the decline of the Israeli kibbutz, two of the reports from the BBC's correspondents. First on BBC Two, the news and sport with Moira Stewart and Helen Rollison.
The hostages freed by the Bosnian Serbs have been handed over to the UN and are being flown to Zagreb. But the Bosnian Serbs warn no more will be released unless there's a guarantee of no fresh airstrikes. And here, relief for the families now that the 11 British soldiers are on their way to safety. In South Africa, the England players being targeted by the rugby league men with the checkbooks. Good evening. The first of the UN hostages released in Bosnia are due to arrive shortly in the Croatian capital, Zagreb. But there's confusion tonight about when the remaining hostages will be freed. The Bosnian Serbs say they won't release them until they get a guarantee of no more airstrikes.
It had been a long, tiring journey, and it wasn't finished until 5 o'clock this morning, when the 11 British soldiers, 63 Frenchmen, 41 Canadians, plus several Danes and Swedes, were brought to an hotel in Novi Sad. They'd left 257 other hostages behind them, together, it's thought, with the pilot of the crashed American F-16 plane, which the Bosnian Serbs shot down yesterday. He's said to have survived and to have been taken prisoner. The hotel where the released hostages were kept was unremarkable enough, but the Serbian authorities guarded it carefully. They didn't want anyone to get too near. The few men who were allowed to show themselves, these were some of the Canadian contingent, were obviously relieved to be free. Some of the French soldiers in particular had been allowed by their captors to keep their weapons. There was no sign of the 11 men from the Royal Welsh Fusiliers, but they were visited by the British Chargé d'Affaires from Belgrade.
I spoke to all our British soldiers.
The normally dapper Ivor Roberts had spent most of the night here and hadn't yet had a chance to shave. I asked him if the other hostages would now be freed.
There is a dynamic in the situation which I hope will carry us through to the release of all the hostages. Obviously, it's very good news to have 11 of ours, our soldiers, and 121 of the whole Amprofor contingent of hostages released, but we're not going to be happy until they're all out.
The Serbian government here has put immense pressure on the unruly Bosnian Serbs to get these hostages free, but the rest aren't out yet. And indeed, a spokesman for the Bosnian Serb leadership was aggressive tonight about the chances of freedom soon for the other 250.
We are not going to release the prisoners if the option of using force against us, to be more specific, of launching airstrikes against us, is not abandoned.
So the crisis over the hostages isn't over yet. John Simpson, BBC News, Belgrade.
The relatives of the 11 Welsh Fusiliers who've been released say they're relieved, but they won't celebrate until all the hostages are freed.
Peacekeepers were driven across the Serbian border early this morning.
Today's release ended a week of extreme anxiety for Cardiff publican Roger McCabe, whose son Stephen was among the freed Fusiliers, but his thoughts were also with the parents of those still held captive.
We won't celebrate properly till all the hostages are gone, because all the other families, they're still worried about their sons and brothers and whatever. So until everybody's out, then we can properly celebrate.
Celebrations were on hold too for the parents of another released soldier, Lawrence Parry. Despite the experience of the last few days, his mother supports the British Army's mission in Bosnia.
Every career has its advantages and disadvantages, and I'm afraid when you're in the army you have to take some of the difficult ones as well. So yes, I do support him 100%. And I support the action they're doing there.
For the families of the Royal Welsh Fusiliers who have been released, today's news has come as a tremendous relief. For the others, the unpredictability of the Bosnian Serbs means that despite the optimistic signs, the worrying will continue until they too have definite news that the rest of the hostages have been freed. Tim Hirsch, BBC News, Wrexham.
Defence ministers from 15 countries meeting in Paris to discuss the Bosnian crisis have agreed to set up a rapid reaction force. British soldiers would form well over half of the 10,000-strong air mobile force. Its main role would be to protect UN peacekeepers.
Finally, ministers believe their policies are catching up with events in Bosnia as they announce the sending of two brigades of up to 10,000 fresh soldiers. It transforms the military capability of UNPROFOR, but it's not intended to start a war, just protect the peacekeepers. And no one's pretending it's a complete solution.
It will not resolve all the problems of the United Nations, and we must be very careful not to give rise to any expectations that we are not confident can be delivered.
British soldiers will be the largest contingent, with troops now on their way to Bosnia being part of a multinational rapid reaction brigade. But on top of that, the second unit will be the entirely British 5,000 strong 24 Air Mobile Brigade. The French will provide the bulk of the other forces, which will be under a UN chain of command, although probably they won't paint their vehicles white, acknowledgement of their more military role.
Nous considérons qu'une attitude de fermeté.
French Defence Minister Charles Meon said a tough stance was now the only way to move the peace process forward. The Americans won't be sending troops, but they are being lavish with offers of equipment, including the loan of attack helicopters and help with intelligence gathering. Ministers left knowing their decision meant UN peacekeepers will probably never have been so well equipped. What's still unknown is how willing the UN will be to use this extra fighting power. Mark Leite, BBC News, Paris.
Other news now, and the former Conservative minister, Sir Nicholas Scott, has been bailed to appear at Chelsea police station next month after a car accident involving a young child. It's reported Sir Nicholas was arrested and breathalysed on Thursday night after leaving the scene of the accident. He's not been charged with an offence. Figures published by the Halifax Building Society show that house prices are still falling. They dropped by 0.9% last month for the third month in a row. Conservative backbenchers have warned ministers that the party will suffer political damage if confidence in the housing market isn't restored.
The sluggish housing market has hit estate agents, mortgage lenders and homeowners alike. Ministers are now being warned that the government will suffer too if there's no recovery in this politically sensitive sector of the economy.
There's no way that the Chancellor can any longer avoid the wrath of Middle England, as he's called them, if they see their house prices going down for the remainder of this year. For both economic and political reasons, it's vital that he acts quickly.
And Tory backbenchers too are demanding specific measures to help revive the housing market.
Special help for first-time buyers, perhaps some form of tax relief for people in negative equity to help them get out of it. I think we could give tax relief on insurance premiums that new borrowers are going to take out to protect themselves if they are made unemployed.
But Labour say government policies are damaging the chances of a recovery in house prices.
The first thing the government should do is abandon their proposal to make the situation worse, and that is taking away the income support floor that protects people if they lose their jobs. That's the thing that's broken the camel's back.
But the planning any package before the budget in November, and ministers clearly hope that the economic situation and the housing market in particular will look much healthier by then, making any special measures for mortgage holders unnecessary. But the Chancellor is being warned that the budget will be too late, especially if he's forced to give in to pressure from the Governor of the Bank of England to raise interest rates again as early as next week. Lance Price, BBC News.
Now, with the latest on the Rugby World Cup and the England-Japan Soccer International at Wembley, here's Helen Rollison.
A Rugby League club chairman has claimed that six members of the England Rugby Union squad at the World Cup have been approached to turn professional. Representatives of at least four clubs are in South Africa to sign players for the start of the Super League next year. From Durban, our sports correspondent Rob Bonnet reports.
The man making the claim is the chairman of Sheffield Eagles, Gary Hetherington, who's in South Africa on a shopping trip for prospective rugby league players. He says that at least six of England's current squad, including Mike Catt, Neil Back and Victor Obogu, have been approached by officials of top English professional clubs. Wigan, Warrington and Leeds are known to be represented here, all of them backed by new satellite TV money and looking to persuade World Cup stars to switch to rugby league.
A lot of them are ready to make the change, there's no doubt about that. And provided the offer is right and the environment is right, then yes, they are ready to make that change.
We're not surprised that perhaps they are now trying to focus on, you know, one or two people in the England squad, which is a very successful squad and some very good players in it. I don't think there'll be a mass exodus of these players anyway, and I think that they see many of them see their future still in rugby union.
What some of these players must ultimately decide is whether the big money but short-term attractions of rugby league outweigh the advantages likely to be forthcoming in rugby union, where the regulations concerning permitted commercial activities are set to be relaxed later this summer.
But this is an international shop window, and the giant New Zealand star Jonah Lomu is already the big target for Sheffield Eagles.
It'd certainly be an asset to Sheffield Eagles at Donvalley Stadium, and I would like to think that he could well be wearing our colours next year.
Has he given you any indication that he might want to come to England?
Yes, he has.
And other players likely to command £1 million contracts in rugby league include the South African star James Small. Rob Bonnet, BBC News at the Rugby World Cup in South Africa.
Scotland lost a thrilling match against France in Pretoria tonight,